The Gospel of John, chapter 19, please. God's put on my heart a message today that's a little bit different, but by God's grace, we will be blessed by it. I've titled it Betrayal or Bravery. John chapter 19, start at verse 31. I'll read till the end of the chapter. John chapter 19, verse 31 through verse 42. The Jews, therefore, because it was the preparation that the body should not remain upon the cross on the Sabbath day, for that Sabbath day was a high day, besought Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. Then came the soldiers and brake the legs of the first and of the other, which was crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was dead already, they brake not his legs. But one of the soldiers with a spear pierced his side, and forthwith came there out blood and water. And he that saw it bare record, and his record is true, and he knoweth that he saith true, that ye might believe. For these things were done, that the scripture should be fulfilled, a bone of him shall not be broken. And again another scripture saith, they shall look on him whom they pierced. And after this, Joseph of Arimathea, being a disciple of Jesus, but secretly for fear of the Jews, besought Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus. And Pilate gave him leave. He came therefore and took the body of Jesus. And there came also Nicodemus, which at the first came to Jesus by night, and brought a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 100 pound weight. Then took they the body of Jesus and wound it in linen clothes with the spices, as the manner of the Jews is to bury. Now in the place where he was crucified there was a garden, and in the garden a new sepulchre, wherein was never man laid. There laid they Jesus, therefore, because of the Jews' preparation day, for the sepulchre was nigh at hand. Father, I thank you again for being able to look into Scripture and to see great things. Of course, what we see as we've read just now is that Jesus Christ willingly went to that cross and shed his blood, paid for sin by dying on that cross. And he died. He was buried. He just didn't fall into a trance or anything, but he really, literally was dead on that cross. That centurion that pierced his side gave a true record of it. And so, Father, we thank you that though he was buried, he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. And every time we meet on the first day of the week, we remember that Jesus Christ rose victorious over death and hell and the grave, and victorious over sin, so that we can have that same victory when we come to him. Lord, I pray that you'd bless that those that hear this, whether it be in my church family that are here this morning or over the internet, that their lives would be changed because we've looked at these characters this morning. So help us for your glory. Give me the wisdom and power of the Holy Spirit. It's not me. Oh, Lord, I know that. It's only what you can do as you show forth Jesus Christ in the lives of these Bible characters. So, Lord, do some great things. We'll thank you as we only can. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. You may be seated. There are two men that I want to talk about this morning whose lives interact with Jesus. And these two men are Judas and Nicodemus. They both have some to do with his death and burial and resurrection. And so I want to take a look at that. I believe God gives us names in Scriptures for two reasons. One, to know who to follow. Amen? I want to be like so-and-so. We sing a song, Dare to Be Like Daniel. You know, I want to be like some of the people that are in the Bible. And then, of course, the second reason he gives names in the Bible is there's people we need to shun. There's some people I don't want to be like. Amen? I really don't want to be like them. And I think that it's It's very true here. If I'm going to take a look this morning and contrast Judas and Nicodemus, there's one I don't want to be like. Amen. And then there's another I really do want to be like, Nicodemus. I really do. There's some similarities that the two of them have. They both knew Jesus. Both knew him. They both did things for Jesus. Amen? And they both had dealings with the cross of Calvary. Judas to bring Jesus to the trial with Pilate and before the Sanhedrin of the Jews and all that kind of thing. And then after his death, we see Nicodemus, where we read today, he brings the spices for the burying of Jesus Christ. But they also have some things that are dissimilar, and I'll get to those. But I have in my mind, I have a picture that they possibly knew each other. Now, we'll discover further on about Judas that he is of Judah. Isn't that amazing? Right? They call him Judas, but he is from Judah, and Nicodemus, of course, is from that same area, Judah, where Jerusalem is located. But I wonder if this happened. Now, this isn't in Scripture. This is just my mind just wondering, my mind kind of going through things. I wonder if some night Nicodemus didn't find Judas and say to him, look, I don't want anybody to know anything about this, but I want to support the ministry of Jesus, so here's some money. Of course, Judas would have liked that. We know that he liked carrying the bag, and he would have liked that thing. But I kind of wonder if they didn't meet at some point. It's possible. I mean, we have no scriptural backing. We have nothing. It's just my thinking. You know, pastor thinks weird sometimes. Amen? But I just kind of think, you know, how did they get supported? I mean, people gave them monies all different times. And I can just picture if Nicodemus came to Jesus by night, you know, that some night he found Judas and said, hey, I'd like to give some money. You know, but I don't want anybody to know about it. I can just see how that thing could have played out. But here are some ways that they were dissimilar. One appeared to be close to Jesus Christ, and one followed afar off. Now, Judas was there. He's one of the 12. We see Judas at the Last Supper. One of them betrayed Jesus Christ, and one of them defended Jesus Christ. See, they're not similar in a lot of ways. Amen? One of them was a taker, Judas, and one was a giver. One of them hung himself after Jesus died. The other one stood out for Jesus Christ after he died. There's some parts of Nicodemus I want to be like. I hope you will too. Jesus rose from the dead 3 days after his crucifixion and burial. These men are included in the account of his death and burial and resurrection, and they're here for a reason. I want to look, first of all, this morning at Judas Iscariot. That's how he's listed in Scriptures. Now, there's many passages about him. We're not going to turn to all the passages about Judas. He shows up in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. He shows up in all four gospel accounts, and so he's there. We don't know why or how Jesus chose him. Do you realize that? You know, we don't see. I mean, we know that, like, Peter and Andrew, you know, Andrew came when Jesus was being baptized, and Andrew said, I found the Messiah, and brought Peter. And, you know, we see some of the, comes up to Matthew and says, follow me, and he left being the, you know, the publican and followed him. We see some things about some of the others, but we don't about Judas. If you look there in Matthew chapter 10 and verse 1 through 4 in Matthew chapter 10, we just have, and some of the men are listed kind of matter-of-factly. It says there in Matthew chapter 10, verse 1 through 4, and when he had called unto him his 12 disciples, he gave them power against unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease. Now the names of the 12 apostles are these: the first, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew his brother, James the son of Zebedee, and John his brother, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew the publican, James the son of Alphaeus, and Lebeus, whose surname was Thaddeus, Simon the Canaanite, and Judas Iscariot, who also betrayed him. And every list that you find where the men are all laid out, therefore, as the 12 men are named, Judas is always the last one. He's always at the end. Now, they mix them up a little bit different in different places, but he's the last one. Jesus must have saw some potential in him and offered him salvation. Right to the very end, Jesus offered him salvation. At that Last Supper, before Judas goes out and betrays Jesus, he says to him, you know, here's the sop. Here's the best morsel. Here's the tie that would bring us together. And he still betrays Jesus Christ. I don't know why. I really don't understand that. But Jesus saw in him that potential, but he rejected it. Now, he's called Judas Iscariot because of the city that he came from. It's a city in Judah called Kiriath. It starts with a K. We're going to take a look there in Joshua chapter 15, if you will. Joshua chapter 15, verse 21 introduces us to what's going on in Joshua chapter 15. If you look there at verse 21, it says, "And the uttermost cities of the tribe of the children of Judah toward the coast of Edom southward were Kabzeel and Eder and Jagur." So these are the cities of Judah, and there's quite the list that goes on down through here. But then take a look at verse 25. It says, "And Hazar and Hadatha and Kiriath and Hezron, which is Hazor." So here's that Kiriath, and he's Judas Iscariot. You know, the change from the Hebrew to the Greek in the New Testament. So he's from this city of Judah. And it makes him the only one of Judah, not of Galilee. All the others are from Galilee. Kind of interesting when you think about that. He was the treasurer, but the scripture tells us he was also a thief. Look there in John chapter 12, verse 3 through 6. John's Gospel, chapter 12, verse 3 through 6. Judas was the treasurer for the group, if you will. And the Word of God tells us here, starting at verse 3, "Then took Mary a pound of ointment of spikenard, very costly, and anointed the feet of Jesus, and wiped his feet with her hair. And the house was filled with the odor of the ointment. Then saith one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, which should betray him, why was not this ointment sold for 300 pence and given to the poor? This he said, not that he cared for the poor, but because he was a thief, and had the bag and bare what was put therein." So he was the treasurer. He bore the bag. He carried the money bag around. And when somebody would give some money, he'd put it in the bag and he'd not tell the others how much. Some of it went into his own pocket. He was a thief. Probably the men figured it out. The men probably saw somebody hand him 3 coins and he'd give a tally that he only got 2. They figured it out, but I guess they turned a blind eye to it. I suppose that every need was met. They'd have to be that way. Anytime they had to pay for something, I imagine that he paid for it. So they said, well, everything's paid for. We don't really care. It's kind of like how people are with our government. Everything's paid for, so we really don't care what they do. When they should, amen. Well, enough of that for today. That was enough of that kind of thing. But we know that Mary anointed Jesus for his burial. Verse 7 here of John chapter 12 says, "Then said Jesus, let her alone. Against the day of my burying hath she kept this. For the poor always ye have with you, but me ye have not always." Jesus Christ rose from the dead And then he, later on, 50 days later, he rose up to heaven. He ascended up into heaven. And Judas was opposed here. He thought it was a waste of money. And he made the lie here about the poor. Oh, it should be given to the poor. No, that 100 pence, probably 60 would have went in the bag and 40 would have went in his pocket. You know, maybe it would have been 40 in the bag, 60 in his pocket. Who knows? But he was lying about that poor thing. We don't know why exactly he betrayed Jesus Christ. We have no idea. Maybe it was that he wanted Rome's overthrow so bad, and you know, being someone from Judah right there, that he thought Jesus should have led the charge and they should have overthrown Rome and gotten Rome out of Israel, and you know, he'd have been the king there. Maybe that's what it was. Maybe it was that after he'd been with Jesus for those 3 years, 3.5 years, that he figured, well, Jesus really isn't the Messiah. He isn't the one I thought he was. I don't know. I really, really don't know. But I do know that here in John chapter 13, verse 27, during that supper when Jesus gives him the sop, verse 27 says, "And after the sop, Satan entered into him. Then said Jesus unto him, That thou doest, do quickly." A person who does not know Jesus Christ as Savior can be controlled by Satan, by the devils. They can be controlled by them. I know that. I understand that. So Satan entered into him and he went out and did the dirty work, did the betrayal. I find it interesting that he betrayed Jesus in a garden. You know, Adam and Eve were betrayed in the garden. Satan entered into the serpent and betrayed them in the garden. Jesus Christ, to be our sin bearer, was betrayed in a garden. And he was betrayed with a kiss, a token of affection. Even Jesus remarked, "Betrayest thou me with a kiss?" Now, to some, we have to understand, you know, they didn't have park lights in that garden. They didn't have any kind of lights except what they brought with them. And so it could have been hard to distinguish Jesus Christ, although I'm sure every one of the ones that came in that band, in that mob, that throng, that vigilante group to get him, I imagine every one of them at some point or other had seen Jesus. But in the dark, just to make sure, Judas walks up, gives him a kiss. And from that point on, we see that Jesus goes through a horrific trial that's not fair in the least way. Goes through the whole beating and scourging with Pilate and the whole fiasco of the plants in the crowd so that the people would yell out, "Crucify him, crucify him." We see then Jesus Christ hanging on that cross at Calvary's Hill, dying, bleeding for us. Then he's buried. And then we come to Nicodemus at the end of Christ's life there. But praise God, on that third day he rose again. Praise the Lord. Judas, as wicked as he was, the betrayer that he was, still didn't conquer Jesus Christ. He rose from the grave. So I'd like to turn our attention to Nicodemus. I don't want to be like Judas. I want to be like Nicodemus. Nicodemus is only found in John's gospel. You can't find him, Matthew, Mark, Luke. It's the only place he's found. Tradition says that he was the richest man in Jerusalem at that time. And we get this tradition because tradition also tells us that he was the brother of Josephus, the Jewish historian. And it's interesting that Josephus, even though he's Jewish and not a follower of Jesus Christ and writes about the Jews all the way up through the Maccabean time, he writes strongly about Jesus Christ and who he was and that he died on the cross and that he rose again. He's very strong about it. And he doesn't put in any language about, well, we think, you know, they want us to think this happened, you know, it was just some kind of political speak, you know. I mean, he doesn't do any kind of hedging about it. I mean, he states it as fact. And you wonder if he doesn't state it that way because here's his brother Nicodemus living a new life, born again in Jesus Christ, you know, telling him over and over and over again, Josephus, you need to trust Jesus as your Savior. We know about Josephus that he was, I'm sorry, we know about Nicodemus rather, let me get back here right. We know about him that he was a Pharisee and on the Sanhedrin. When we first meet him in John chapter 3, John's Gospel chapter 3 is where we first meet Nicodemus. We read there chapter 3, verse 1. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. So the ruler of the Jews, that's part of the Sanhedrin. That's what they were called, the Sanhedrin, and he was a Pharisee. We know that about him. And he first comes to Jesus by night. Verse 2 of chapter 3 tells us, the same came to Jesus by night and said unto him, Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher come from God, for no man can do these miracles that thou doest except God be with him. And so he recognizes that he's got to be from God, but he doesn't quite understand all about him. Well, then Jesus says to him in verse 3, Jesus answered and said unto him, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. And we're introduced to this idea through Nicodemus that ye must be born again. That's what verse 7 says. Marvel not that I said unto thee, ye must be born again. And of course, at first, Nicodemus thought there at verse 7, how can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? And Jesus wasn't talking about a physical birth. He was talking about a spiritual rebirth. Jesus answered him in verse 5, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. Born of the water doesn't mean that you're baptized and that's how you get saved. Born of the water means that the water breaks in the woman's womb and she knows then she's going to deliver the baby. And if you're not born the first time, you can't be born the second time. It just how that works. You know, you have to be born that way. And that's what he's talking about. You have to be born of the Spirit. So a great thing, great, just a wonderful thing that we are introduced here with Nicodemus. Tradition tells us that he must have trusted Jesus Christ. Where, when, we're not sure, but he must have, because after the resurrection of Jesus Christ, he was thrown off the Sanhedrin. Not only that, but he was so persecuted in Jerusalem that he was forced to leave the city and leave all his treasures behind. Well, I want you to take a look at a second encounter that we have. Now, the only three places he shows up in John. Here's the second one. It's in John's Gospel, chapter 7, verse 42, and I'd like to read through verse 53 if I could. John chapter 7, starting at verse 42 through the end of the chapter. Here we read, and you know, there's an encounter that's gone on with Jesus in Jerusalem. And so here we pick it up at verse 42. Hath not the scripture said that Christ cometh of the seed of David and out of the town of Bethlehem where David was? So there was a division among the people because of him. And this division is the fact that Jesus Christ is living in Nazareth. And so they talk of him as the Nazarene, Jesus of Nazareth. Yeah, that's what they talk of him. But we know where he was born. Now you say, Pastor, this is a message for the Resurrection Sunday, for what the world calls Easter Sunday. You're not going to bring in the Christmas message, are you? Well, yeah. I am, as a matter of fact. Yeah. Jesus was born in Bethlehem because he's of the house and lineage of David. Yeah. That's where he's born. And of course, his family was from Galilee and they lived there, but they both, Joseph and Mary, were of the house and lineage of David. And that's where he was born, but they don't think of those things. Isn't that something? So there was division. Verse 44, if you would. And some of them would have taken him, but no man laid hands on him. Then came the officers to the chief priests and Pharisees. And they said unto them, why have ye not brought him? So here they are, the chief priests and Pharisees. We're back at the Sanhedrin in verse number 45. And they're saying, why didn't you bring Jesus in? You know, here are the officers. Some of them would have taken him, but no man laid hands on him, verse 44 told us. Verse 46, the officers answered, never man spake like this man. Isn't that the truth? There's no other one, anytime, anywhere, anybody has ever spoken like Jesus Christ to tell people they must be born again. No. The leaders of religion today say, hey, follow me, follow this, and do these things. But Jesus said, no, you must be born again. What a big difference. Great big difference. Got to be born of the Spirit, not just walk and follow and do these things and take my advice and all that. No, be born again. So why haven't you brought them in? No man spake like this man. Then answered them the Pharisees, are ye also deceived? Have any of the rulers or of the Pharisees believed on him? And I think Nicodemus was there and saying, I have. Kind of timid about it. I have. But this people who knoweth not the law are cursed. Can you imagine them saying that about all the people? The Pharisees were saying, we are the only ones that are not cursed. Because we know the law. We know what God's word says. But all the common people that are out there, they're cursed. Every one of them. Cursed means they're on their way to hell. Can you imagine them thinking that way? What an incredible thing. Verse 50, Nicodemus saith unto them, he that came to Jesus by night being one of them. By the way, every time Judas comes up, he's always said he betrayed Jesus. He's the one who betrayed Jesus. Nicodemus, whenever he comes up, he's the one who came to Jesus by night. I don't know what you want people to say about you, but I don't want them to say, I betrayed Jesus. I'd rather say, he came to him, yeah, well, it was by night, but he came to him. Nicodemus saith unto them, he that came to Jesus by night, being one of them, doth our law judge any man before it hear him and knoweth what he doeth? I mean, he's not saying anything there except that if you're going to condemn Jesus, you'd better hear him first. That's what our law says about our trials. Wow, boy, verse 52, the fangs come out, the claws come out. They just jump on him. They answered and said unto him, art thou also of Galilee? Search and look. For out of Galilee ariseth no prophet. Wow. They jump on this poor Nicodemus. They really get after him. And then verse 53, and every man went unto his own house. It's like they just jumped up after they yelled that at him and all left. He's got no recourse here. What an incredible thing that happens. So after they returned empty-handed, nearly believing, Nicodemus reminds them of the Jewish law. But they come back with two lies. The first lie that they have is that Jesus was of Galilee. That lie I think I dismissed earlier because verse 42 told us that Christ cometh of the seed of David and out of the town of Bethlehem where David was, and that's where he was born. Too bad they didn't look in their records. too bad they didn't leave that building, wherever it was, where the Sanhedrin went, and walked over to the temple where they kept record of all the births, and took a look there and saw that it was recorded Jesus was born in Bethlehem because he was of the house and lineage of David. Or if not that, go over and knock on the Roman soldier's door who took the census and say, where did they register? Oh, Bethlehem, because they're of the house and lineage of David. That was the first lie. And then the second lie, search and look, for out of Galilee ariseth no prophet. That's a lie. There are two prophets that are out of Galilee. The first one is Jonah. Say, Jonah? Yeah. Take a look with me in 2 Kings chapter 14, if you would. 2 Kings chapter 14. What in the world is he going to show us here in 2 Kings chapter 14? Well, take a look. 2 Kings chapter 14, and look with me here at verse number 25. This is talking about Jeroboam. And it says here, in verse 25, he restored the coast of Israel from the entering of Hamath unto the sea of the plain, according to the word of the Lord God of Israel, which he spake by the hand of his servant Jonah, the son of Amittai, the prophet, which was of Gath-Hepher. Now, Gath-Hepher is in Galilee. It's just to the south and to the west of the Sea of Gennesaret. Yeah, that's in Galilee. You can look on some of the maps at the back of your Bible when you get home, and you'll find Gath-Hepher is there. Sea of Galilee. The other prophet is none other. Oh, and by the way, isn't it something that Jesus said? Just like Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the whale, so shall I be in the heart of the earth. 3 days, three nights later, he arose from the dead. And Jonah's from Galilee. Isn't that an interesting kind of thing? The other one is Nahum. And Nahum, we find there, is in his book, chapter 1. That small little book of Nahum. After Micah comes Nahum. And then you'll find, after Nahum, you get Habakkuk, and Zephaniah, and Haggai, and Zechariah, and Malachi. So if you start at Matthew and start going back little books at a time, you'll come to Nahum. And verse 1 says, the burden of Nineveh, the book of the vision of Nahum, the Elkoshite. And an Elkoshite was another one of those villages in Galilee. In Galilee. So that's where he is, from Galilee. So they lied. I'd like to look at the third time that we see in the Gospel of John, Nicodemus. So go there where we read in chapter 19. Here's the third time we see Nicodemus, and it's in chapter 19. In chapter 19, we read here again, verse 38, and after this, Joseph of Arimathea, being a disciple of Jesus, but secretly for fear of the Jews, besought Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus. And Pilate gave him leave. He came therefore and took the body of Jesus. And there came also Nicodemus, which at the first came to Jesus by night, and brought a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 100 pound weight. Then took they the body of Jesus and wound it in linen clothes with the spices, as the manner of the Jews is to bury. Now in the place where he was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new sepulchre, wherein was never man yet laid. There laid they Jesus, therefore, because of the Jews' preparation day, for the sepulchre was nigh at hand. Here it is. They've got this preparation day. You noticed where I read earlier when we started this message at verse 31, it said there, the Jews therefore, because it was the preparation that the body should not remain on the cross on the Sabbath day, for that Sabbath day was a high day. besought Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. The reason for breaking their legs was so they could no longer push up and get the air into their lungs. The way they were crucified by the Romans had it such that when they hung with their arms nailed up in the air the way they were, they couldn't breathe. And the fluids were all building into their lungs, and they eventually would die of a heart attack. It was a painful, terrible way. They'd go on for days. Some men would go on for days before they actually would die. Great agony. And of course, every time they pushed up on the nail that was in their foot, the pain that would be there, it would be such that their legs would spasm and they couldn't do it anymore, and they'd sink back down again. And so they'd come by and break their legs so that they couldn't push up anymore and they'd die quickly. Of course, they'd break their legs in such a way that they'd bleed. They wouldn't just crack them. They'd break them so they broke through the skin. Multiple fracture. So that they were, they'd just bleed out in their legs, die quickly. Now this Jewish preparation, it's interesting. It says that they should not remain on the Sabbath. They didn't want any bodies out in the open, any dead bodies around for this. It would have polluted their holy days. Now you have to remember, Passover was one day. Then the next day after Passover started the Feast of Weeks. I got it backwards there. The Feast of Weeks. So they had festival time afterward. Now, Scripture tells us here, for that Sabbath day, this is John chapter 19, verse 31, for that Sabbath day was a high day. It was the start of their feast. And they were making preparations for it. Now, this year, 2010, Passover was on Tuesday. So Wednesday would have started that week, the Feast of Weeks. Okay? That would have been when that started for the Jews. So that would have been their high Sabbath day, but it wasn't Saturday, the normal Jewish Saturday. So they get all mixed up about when was Jesus crucified and when was he buried and all that kind of thing. Try to make it out to be Friday. Can't be Friday. It just couldn't be, because that would have been the preparation for the normal Sabbath day, but not for this high Sabbath day that's mentioned here. So, it couldn't have been. And, of course, you can't get 3 days and three nights if he's crucified on Friday. It just doesn't work out. You can't. No modern math can make it work. Amen, folks? Modern math can't do it. So they needed to get the bodies down. And here's Joseph of Arimathea that comes along. And I think that they had some kind of a conversation. I think Joseph was probably one of the rich men in Jerusalem at the time as well, because he's got a tomb and he's got a garden that goes with the tomb. And I think that the conversation went this way. Joseph says to Nicodemus, "I'll go to Pilate and beg the body. I've got power and pull there. I'll go get the body from Pilate. You go for the spices." So they head out in different directions and they meet back where they're taking Jesus down from the cross. It's interesting here at verse 39 of John 19, it says that Nicodemus, which at the first came to Jesus by night and brought a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 100-pound weight. Would you look with me, keep your finger here, we'll come back, Psalm 45 and verse 8. Psalm 45, verse 8. We get a song from this, a hymn that we sing, Psalm 45, verse 8. And the Word of God says this, "All thy garments," I'm at Psalm 45, verse 8, "all thy garments smell of myrrh and of aloes and cassia out of the ivory palaces whereby they have made thee glad." And we sing that hymn, out of the ivory palaces, Jesus left all of that, came here to earth to be the Savior, to be the one who died on the cross and to rise and be our eternal life in Jesus Christ. And here, all thy garments smell of myrrh and of aloes and cassia. Just what they wrapped him in, the myrrh and the aloes. We see that he was brought here to this tomb, and in the garden, the Word of God tells us, and for if you want to take a look there, Matthew chapter 27, verse 60. Matthew chapter 27, verse 60. The Word of God tells us this. In Matthew chapter 27, verse 60. And laid it in, maybe we need to pick it up at verse 57 so we know what we're talking about here. It says this, when the evening was come, there came a rich man of Arimathea named Joseph, who also himself was Jesus' disciple. He went to Pilate and begged the body of Jesus. Then Pilate commanded the body to be delivered. And when Joseph had taken the body, he wrapped it in a clean linen cloth and laid it in his own new tomb, which he had hewn out in the rock, and he rolled a great stone to the door of the sepulcher and departed. His own tomb. It's amazing. Here he was. He had a tomb. It was right there near where the crucifixion took place at Calvary, and put him in his own tomb. It's interesting. Jesus went from a virgin womb to a virgin tomb. And he rose again from the dead. Well, let me just close by asking, which of the two men do you want to be? Be thought of, be followers of. There was Judas, seemed to be close to Jesus, walked with him, sat down and ate with him, was in the boat with him. Everybody would have looked at Judas and said, yep, he's one of them. Or Nicodemus came by night. Nicodemus who didn't stand out. Nicodemus who's only found here three times in the Gospel of John. And yet, when it counted, Nicodemus was faithful to the Lord. Which of the followers of Jesus will you be? Let's pray together. We've got our heads bowed and our eyes closed. You that are on the internet, get serious with God. If you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior, as he said to Nicodemus, ye must be born again. Your sin is keeping you from ever having any kind of fellowship with God Almighty. He's a holy God. Oh yes, I know he's merciful. That's why he sent Jesus Christ. But the only way that you can come to the Father is through Jesus. You must repent of your sin and by faith take Jesus Christ as your Savior and him only. Not him and your good works, him and your church and its activities, but Jesus Christ as your Savior. Pray today. Cry out to him today. Oh, Jesus, be merciful to me, a sinner that deserves hell. Come and be master of my life today. Lord Jesus, I'm sorry for my sin. Save me. Put that blood that was shed at Calvary's cross on my account and wash me clean, that I might have heaven and have a life down here that's pleasing to you. You that know Jesus Christ as Savior, is it all show? Is it like Judas? Underneath, he was a thief and a liar and a betrayer. Or might it be more like Nicodemus, who was true to the Lord even to the end? All the disciples fled from that garden. We don't see that the disciples took Jesus down and buried Jesus. We've got Joseph and Nicodemus and some women watched. Nicodemus spent a lot of money to buy those spices. He gave of himself for the Lord. Would you follow him? Father, I come before you. I thank you again that you're a great and mighty God. I pray that you would continue to bless and help each one of us. If there's one that doesn't know Jesus as Savior, would you help them to see their need and come to Jesus? Those of us that know him as Savior, would you show us the ways that even though we follow you in our heart, we've got some things that need to get rid of. In our heart, we've got sin that betrays Jesus over and over again. Help us to be like Nicodemus. Help us to defend the Lord. Help us to tell others that they must be born again. Help us to give of ourselves for the service of the Lord. We